I'm deciding to take a break from all of the mainline AAA Nintendo titles and focus primarily on the more underrated outdated releases to give the show a bit more variety and spice things up as we head into the new decade. Indie games, or just games with a more independent feel, have always been games I've loved playing growing up. I got into indie games thanks to the Xbox Live Marketplace. It's funny because I never really knew what the term indie meant back then. Look, I was like 12 years old and had really bad vocabulary. I also used to think quote-unquote indie games was just another genre of video games not really tied together with the bigger mainline titles on the Xbox Live Marketplace. Yes, I'm a dumbass, I know. Regardless of that, indie games had a huge impact on my life, and the first game to get me hooked was none other than Castle Crashers. Castle Crashers was one of those games I immediately got into upon finding out about it on Xbox Live. It was just one of those games that kinda stood out, you know, with all the colors and unique art style and cast of characters. It's safe to assume that I had my work cut out for me, and to some extent, yeah, mainly due to the fact that this game is better to be played with other people, as this is a 4-player co-op adventure game, and going into this game by myself, especially now, when I used to play this game with family and friends a lot back in the day, is gonna be pretty lonely, but the show must go on. Created and developed by the Behemoth, the same company responsible for creating Alien Hominid, originally a Flash game on Newgrounds before being released on the PS2, Xbox, and Xbox 360, Castle Crashers made its initial release in August of 2008 for Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and Microsoft Windows, then were later re-released in September of 2019 as a remaster for the Xbox One, PS4, and Nintendo Switch, which is actually the version we're going to be looking at today as it's more convenient for me, plus I got it on sale for about 9 bucks around Christmas time. Castle Crashers is, for lack of better terms, a beat-em-up action-adventure game with RPG elements that can be played either locally or online depending on how you prefer to play the game. I'm playing alone this time around, as I mentioned earlier, so let's see how I fare. The story begins with a sort of party that is soon interrupted by a random knight falling in that is seen to be murdered. Upon advancing further, a dark wizard appears before the king and proceeds to steal a giant crystal and takes off with it, and upon advancing even further on, enemies are seen kidnapping princesses, and it's your job to retake the giant crystal from the dark wizard and save all the princesses that were kidnapped. Pretty cliche nowadays, but this is a first for me. Not only do you have to retrieve a giant crystal that was stolen from the king, but you also have to save not one, but multiple princesses, and they're all being held captive by different enemies, so that's a nice change of pace from just saving a princess from one major enemy that acts as the main antagonist of the entire game. I think it's pretty cool that they decided to go with this in the main campaign instead of just having one objective, which would most likely be to just obtain the giant crystal and that's it. Sure, it sounds a bit overwhelming, but it's really not. You save the princesses by just taking down bosses, going down your regular route to finishing the game, and it doesn't feel as though this is just taking up unnecessary time to actually beating the game. It feels like I'm just playing how I normally should, advancing throughout the story. Going more into the bosses, they are, for lack of a better word, hard. I've had so much trouble taking these bosses down. Maybe I just suck, or maybe they're just pretty difficult overall, I don't know. I do know, however, that it is pretty easy to learn their attack patterns to go along with that, but the problem is that these bosses take up half the damn screen at times to where I can't even see my own character. Not to mention their attacks deal a shit ton of damage as well, so it was a lose-lose situation for me regardless. Each level has about 2 bosses in them, and the first boss isn't too bad, especially if you know what you're doing and learn their attack patterns, but the second boss is made to be more difficult than the first, and their attack patterns change the more damage you inflict upon them. A simple balance to keep the gameplay momentum going, if I do say so myself. Of course, as with any game, Castle Crashers wouldn't be what it is without the characters, and there's a decent number of them to start out with. There are your knights seen on the game cover being the red, blue, green, and orange knights, and you also have the pink knight and the purple knight for the more exotic colors. Each knight has their own weapon and magical power element varying from the color they are. For example, the red knight carries a mace and has lightning elemental magic. The characters control completely identical to each other, the only difference being their color, weapons, and magical elements, which is kinda disappointing but understandable. You unlock more characters as you progress throughout the story, which in and of itself is to kinda be expected at this point. I mean, I would hope you unlock these different characters from playing through the overall campaign, I'm just glad they didn't add microtransactions. Imagine paying $2.99 for the King and Dark Wizard individually just for them to have lackluster moves and abilities, that'd be bullshit. The hub world, or level selection screen, is for the most part pretty basic in terms of concept, but the visual aesthetic makes it stand out way more than other traditional puzzle-styled hub worlds. It has a treasure map look to it, fitting the overall setting of the game, most likely paying homage to actual forms of navigation back in the medieval times. Within the hub world, you have levels which you'll need to complete in order to advance further and unlock more items, weapons, skills, etc. There are shops where you can buy different weapons and potions that you will need to progress further because these enemies will be a pain in your ass with their arrows and just overall ganging up on you to see which ones can take you out first. You have the arena game mode that can also be selected in the game's main menu, which is basically a survival mode where you take out as many enemies as you possibly can without dying. Of course, I'm the worst gamer in existence, so I only got past the first two waves of enemies. You also have your blacksmith area, where you can choose from the different weapons you collected along the way at any time, as well as choose and learn about the different creatures you come across while advancing throughout the levels, and if I can be honest, they're pretty helpful. They attack your enemies alongside you, which in dire situations is pretty helpful, but my only nitpick is that they don't attack multiple times, only about once every few hits you do, and even still it's completely random. Just a personal issue of mine, so don't pay that any mind. If I can go back to the bosses for a second, they are fucking ridiculous, some of them at least. For example, there's a bat-like creature you have to take out, and his attack patterns vary from slapping you with his tongue to dropping literal shit on you, and I think that's hilarious. You also get a shit ton of money for taking out some of the more major bosses, so if there are any items and weapons you need to stock up on, then taking out these bosses not only helps you progress further in the game, but also rewards you financially. Going into the game's main menu, it's pretty straightforward in terms of where you need to actually go, and if I'm being honest, this game kinda has two main menus. You have the first menu where you can choose whether or not you want to play locally or online, as well as check your helping options, character stats, and online leaderboards to see how high your rank is compared to other people's. The second menu, which opens up after you select the local game mode, has the visual aesthetic of an old-fashioned book with three modes to choose from, being the Castle Crashers mode, where you play through the main story, the Arena mode, where instead of choosing it while playing through the story, you can choose it here for a much more quicker experience, and it's way more convenient to just do it here anyway, and lastly, the Escape the Barbarian minigame, which is basically a board game where you evade your enemies for as long as possible, spanning across multiple different board game maps. All of these different game modes offer new and exciting experiences for those who wish to spice things up and just relax without worrying about the story and progression. It adds to the level of immersion and passion in my opinion. To just play throughout the story and complete it is such a boring thing to do nowadays, and I honestly prefer to have different things to do in the games I play, hence why I play a lot of games with a lot of stuff to do, because I don't want to just sit there and complete the story. No, that's too boring on its own. I like variety, and this game having some, if not a lot, is good enough for me. The game's level design is based off of a kingdom with castle levels and forests that somehow require animals to shit in order to progress further in the levels, to caves and fortresses to name a few. The world of Castle Crashers is meant to be based off of a kingdom that's at war, and it's nothing new, I know, but it's the way that this game goes about the whole kingdom at war trope that makes it feel fresh. For example, the story elements. You not only have to retrieve a giant crystal that was blatantly stolen from the king right in front of his very eyes, I don't know why he didn't try to stop it, but you also have to save not one, but multiple princesses from being kidnapped by multiple enemies that are working together. And to my knowledge about how kingdoms used to work back in the day, any act of thievery or harm done to one of the kingdom's royal knights would in fact start a war, so I like that this game has actual reasoning behind why you're fighting in the war in the first place. I've played games that took place in a kingdom and involved a war, and a lot of them never really explain why you're fighting, just that you need to fight and defend your kingdom, so seeing a game this bizarre give me multiple reasons as to why I need to fight is a nice change of pace. Now earlier I said that this game has RPG elements in it, which is true to some extent, and I want to go over it more in depth. If you kill a lot of enemies, you earn XP, which can be used to level your character up, and once you level yourself up, you're given new combos and different abilities, which can be upgraded using additional XP on your stats, which you can upgrade every time you die or complete a level. When upgrading your stats, you can upgrade your attack, which boosts your strength and make your attacks all the more lethal, thus inflicting more damage than before. You can upgrade your magic, which boosts the overall power of your spells and can even grant you new spells the more you level up. Your defense, which makes you more durable, meaning you can take more damage without worrying too much about your health. And your agility, which can upgrade your speed for sprinting and attacking. You're gonna need to upgrade these as much as you can in order to progress further into the game, as these enemies seem to multiply more and more in numbers the further you get, not to mention the bosses get more difficult as well. So if you want my honest opinion on what stats to upgrade the most, I'd recommend the strength, defense, and magic, as that's mainly what you'll be using. Upgrade the agility as well, but focus primarily on the three I just mentioned. It is your choice to make at the end of the day though, but for a more, I want to say, smoother run without many issues, focus primarily on those three. The gameplay has a beat-em-up style to it that can be played with three other people, thus making this game a co-op beat-em-up action-adventure game. For the most part, I was running through this game solo, but there are some instances where the computer will fight alongside you in certain levels, making the game seem less lonely. Like most beat-em-up titles, you have two main attacks, being your normal attack that doesn't deal as much damage, and your heavy attack that deals a little bit more damage, but from what I've noticed, it doesn't do a whole lot until after you start upgrading your strength stats. You can also pull off air combos, which can be cheesed to your advantage as many times as you'd like in order to take out enemies more effectively. If you hold down the right bumper and press one of the respected buttons, you can pull off magic attacks that don't deal too much damage at first, but as you go about upgrading your magic, you can make it deal a shit ton and pretty much go through the game with ease. You also have a magic meter which refills after overusage, so upgrading your magic will not only make your spell stronger, but also help with longer use. You can also use your shield to deflect arrows and up-close attacks against enemies, but it only seems useful to just deflect arrows, so I wouldn't try to use this all the time. It also makes you move significantly slower when holding your shield, so be cautious of that. I almost forgot to mention that you can ride horseback on animals during gameplay segments, and it makes you damn near invincible for as long as you're riding it. Castle Crashers made its mark in 2006 with some of the most bizarre level design, really catchy music, simple yet really enjoyable gameplay, as well as really adorable characters regardless if some of them look intimidating. And since playing this wonderful excuse of a beat-em-up, I was introduced to the world of indie games, and ever since then I've grown a huge appreciation for the independent gaming scene. While not as content heavy as many other indie titles out there, Castle Crashers has a decent amount of stuff for you to do, whether you're playing alone or with multiple friends and family. This is a game I can confidently say will be worth your time if you're into the more bizarre style when it comes to beat-em-ups or just games in general. There's not much else I can really say about Castle Crashers at this point, as I feel I've elaborated enough on the game to garner potential interest. If you're looking to purchase this game after watching this episode, I'd recommend the Nintendo Switch version for a more convenient experience for those who prefer to play in portable mode or just like their games on their Nintendo Switch. It's going for about $15 on the Nintendo eShop, so I say go for it if you have the money. And with that being said, I'd like to thank you all so much for watching. I hope you all have an amazing day, and until next time.